Dudgell, committee member, and I used to work for several different audio companies around the area. Last 15 years, I've been working in the renewable energy business and engineering stuff.
I'm Gary Louie. I'm the recording guy at the University of Washington School of Music, and I'm the secretary of the Pacific Northwest AES section.
I'm Thomas Conrad. I'm a journalist, and my primary affiliations are Stereophile and Jazz Times.
Mike Matesky, owner of Opus 4 Studios, musician, owner also a music publishing company.
Okay, it's that time. In 2002, there was an article that appeared in Stereophile magazine called The Search for Roy DuNann, and it was written by Thomas Conrad, who's standing right there. So we thought that it would be good if Thomas kind of led the charge tonight, seeing that it was his article that really sort of started this whole thing off. So I have to confess that I really wasn't aware of Roy's work until I saw the article. And then I went out and searched out some of his work, and I was pleasantly surprised. 50 years later, it still holds its own. It'll still stand on its own two feet. It's amazing stuff. So anyway, I think the format we're going to use tonight is that of an interview. And we'll let Thomas and Roy just interact. And then if you have questions, please hold them for after the break. And then we'll be a free-for-all.
Rick, may I just add one little thing?
Yes.
I found out about Roy purely by coincidence as a musician. Our duo played last December at where Roy and his wife now live. And he happened to be out in the audience. He happened to say that he'd been involved in audio. But then he showed me a card. It said, A&M. I'm from Los Angeles. A&M means something. You don't have to be from Los Angeles for A&M to mean something, by the way. And we talked. And I thought, what the blazes? And so I passed the info on to Rick, for that matter, Steve, and some others. And anyway, it's developed to where we're at now.
Okay. Thomas, it's yours.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good evening. I don't usually do presentations on my stocking feet sitting down, but I think that's what we'll do this evening. Before I do anything else, I want to thank Mike Matesky and Rick Chin, who were absolutely single-mindedly determined that I was going to be here tonight, in spite of all the odds. I came in from Palm Springs, California, had a flight canceled on me earlier today, then had another late flight that was further delayed by headwinds and paperwork issues, and amazingly, I wasn't as late as I thought I was going to be because Jay Biederman rescued me at the airport. But I really want to thank Mike and Rick and Jay for getting me here this evening. I would not have missed it for anything. This opportunity to honor someone who I think is one of the important engineers in the history of the American recording industry, and certainly one of the most important engineers in the history of jazz. And I think we should bring him on without further ado. He's also a great guy and my friend, Roy DuNann.
Thank you.
Have a seat.
Can I sit?
Yep.
Yeah. 88 years of hard work on the bones. Anyway, this is really a surprise for me. Have so many people show up, and I don't know where to start.
Well, I'll start you. It is an impressive turnout indeed. I just want to briefly explain just a bit about my background to explain how I got here. I mentioned it in my introduction. I'm a writer. That has not been my day job really ever in my life. I worked in the audio video retail industry for many years, 22 years for Magnolia Hi-Fi, the last 12 of which I was senior VP COO for Magnolia. Left Magnolia at the end of 04 and have been able to do a lot more writing since then, since I haven't had to balance it with a day job. I started writing for CD Review, if any of you know that magazine, going way back. I wrote for Downbeat for many years. I'm a contributing music editor for Stereophile since the mid-90s and crossed over from Downbeat to Jazz Times a few years ago. As Rick mentioned, we're gonna talk a little bit and then take a break and then open it up to questions from the floor, because I'm sure there will be some. I became curious about Roy DuNann in the mid-70s when I bought some albums on the Contemporary label. I bought them because of the musicians, people like Art Pepper and Sonny Rollins and Andre Previn. But I became very fascinated and curious about the fact that these albums sounded so extraordinary, these LPs. On the record sleeve, it said on the back in fine print, "Sound by Roy DuNann." And I wondered who he was. You know, you don't hear an awful lot about engineers, even hardcore jazz fans. If you ask them to name an engineer, I'll bet a lot of them couldn't. And if any, those who could, if they were asked to name one engineer, would probably name Rudy Van Gelder, the most famous engineer in jazz, who certainly recorded way more albums than Roy and recorded for Blue Note for many, many years, a lot of classic recordings. He did some nice work and they were fun. I was never terribly impressed with certain elements of what Rudy did, especially back in the day, in terms of the sort of cottony pianos and kind of boomy bass and so on. And I was always struck by the fact that Roy's recordings were so superior, and yet you never heard anything about Roy DuNann. By the early 90s, I was writing for Stereophile and really wanted to write an article about Roy if I could find him. So I went searching for him and knew that, of course, he'd been in L.A. because that's where the recordings were made on the Contemporary label. Couldn't find any Roy DuNanns in California. There were some DuNanns. Somebody told me that he'd moved to Arizona. There were no DuNanns at all in the state of Arizona.
Before Google.
Huh? Pardon me?
Before Google.
That was long before Google, so yeah. I was condemned to... That's a good point. I was condemned to, you know, do this by phone. Finally, I talked to a friend of mine, Joe Harley. Some of you may have run into Joe. He works for AudioQuest, the high-end cable company, has for many years as an independent jazz record producer, sort of one of the famous golden ears in the jazz audiophile community. And in that community, people knew about Roy DuNann, or at least, you know, they knew the name, they knew the recordings. Joe Harley certainly did. When I asked Joe about Roy, he said something that I heard again and again whenever I was asking about Roy, and that was, Roy DuNann, I wonder whatever happened to him. I wonder if he's still alive. That was years ago. Joe recommended I talk to Bernie Grundman, because Bernie had once worked for Roy, and Joe knew that, and Bernie runs an important mastering facility in Los Angeles. I talked to Bernie, and he told me something that stopped me cold. He said the last that he had heard, Roy DuNann lived in the Seattle area. So I picked up the phone, called directory assistance, and got a phone number for Roy DuNann and called it, and it answered on about the second ring, and I asked for Roy DuNann, and he said, "Speaking," and I said, "Is this the audio engineer?" And he said, "I used to be." And I was suddenly kind of didn't know what to say next. I said, I've been looking all over for you. And in that sort of dry and intensely logical engineering way that Roy has, as you're about to hear, Roy said, "I've been right here." And so I found him, and Stereophile approved the article, to their credit, approved my doing a 3,500-word article on Roy, which appeared in the April 2002 issue of Stereophile. We are going to get to Roy, I promise, but I thought that maybe even before we do, what might be appropriate is to give you guys a sample of what it was that so intrigued me about this extraordinary engineer and the sound that he was achieving. This album we're going to hear is called Way Out West. It's one of the most famous albums in the history of jazz. The cover's even famous, with Sonny Rollins on the cover in a cowboy suit over there. It has been reissued in every audiophile format known to mankind. In 180 gram vinyl and 45 RPM vinyl and XRCD and SACD. Roy, by the way, when I found him in Bothell, had no idea any of that had gone on. But it's been reissued because it's great music, and the master tape is so special that people are able to get some amazing results by applying their favorite technology, whatever it is. So often, I think we're of a mindset that technology is something that always marches on. You know, today's technology is always better than yesterday's. I mean, in a lot of ways, I suppose it's true. Today's computers are a lot better than those in 1957, a little smaller and stuff. And today's medical technology and today's weapon systems, I suppose, if you're into that. You know, a whole lot of things technological are way better. But this was recorded on March 7, 1957. That's more than 50 years ago. And this is the title track from Way Out West.
No.
Find out how you did it, but before we even get to that, maybe we should kind of start a little bit more at the beginning. I wonder if you could tell us kind of about your early years and your start, how you originally got involved in electronics, and just kind of briefly bring us up to maybe say the end of World War II.
That far? Well, it all started junior high school. I became a radio ham, only one in the school, weren't many around then, and got fiddling around with electronics, all tubes in those days, and went from there to enlisting in the Navy before Pearl Harbor, and went from there to London all of a sudden. They had promised Pearl Harbor, trip to Pearl Harbor and San Diego. But thank goodness I missed Pearl Harbor and went to London to learn about radar. We were just getting into it and went to the British radar school at Portsmouth. And then served with the British Navy, which was kind of unusual, with an American uniform, and kind of a secret deal. We didn't talk much about it. In fact, we weren't even supposed to take our uniforms on the trip over, leave them home, they had told us. But then they changed their mind because it was so hard to get around without a uniform on to the naval bases. And came back, got involved with aircraft and radar, and ran into a couple of guys that were hams, and went to, when I got discharged from the Navy, went to Hollywood, not as right downtown Hollywood, but nearby, and bought a house and started to live there. And I went to work for the Motorola distributor in California, West Coast, I think he was. His name was Kirov. And they had a amateur radio store right after the war ended. Didn't have much to sell, so that didn't last too long, and all of a sudden in the door walks one of the guys I had met in Corpus Christi that was a ham, worked for CBS in Hollywood. And he was looking for a recording device. And I told him, I don't think we have much in the ham radio department. Strange thing happened to me, though, back in 1970, well, before I went in the Navy, my dad had bought a Wilcox Gay recorder. Anybody ever heard of that?
Sure. Crystal clear.
Anyway, it made pretty crude records. And as I recall, it was just 78 RPM, 10-inch blanks, made horrible sounding records. But that was my introduction to the recording business. And anyway, got out of the Navy, and in walks a guy looking for recording equipment. And I said, we don't have anything except, Presto. I had a little portable that they were selling, and Presto was in our catalog for some reason. Anyway, we never sold one, I don't think. About a week later, this guy calls me and says, how would you like to go to work for Capitol Records? And I said, why not? We weren't selling much amateur radio equipment. So it turned out the job that I got was quality control on three phonographs that Capitol got interested in selling to record dealers. One of the guys that started Capitol was Glenn Wallach. No, his father, Clyde Wallach. And he had a record store in Hollywood, the biggest record store in LA. And you could go in and play a record. They're all 78 RPM records then. He had a bunch of little phonographs, crummy little phonographs scattered around the store, little booths kind of. And people were coming in and listening to records and buying them. So he thought it'd be a good idea if Capitol, he helped start Capitol with Johnny Mercer and Buddy DeSilva, motion picture guy. And they made a deal with a builder of equipment in Los Angeles, known as Packard Bell. Made a lot of radios, but they sure didn't know how to make phonographs. they even had a model that you had to crank up. It was just single record player, just real simple to build. Two tubes in there probably and a crank up motor, but none of them would work. Well, half of them would work maybe. So we set up a production, inspection line to check about 500 of these three different models. And we had to send some days 90% of them back to the manufacturer. And they would ship them without loudspeakers. Just impossible.
Doesn't change that much.
They didn't sound so good. Anyway, I did that for about 8 months, I think. And we had a 78, we had to play, that's all we had to play, a 78 RPM shellac. We had a special record that we got Peggy Lee to do a chorus, or we snipped the chorus, not snip it, no tape yet. We stole it off of the record, I guess, or her record. And just sang a chorus, and then it went into a 1,000-cycle tone. And if it was anywhere from 800 to 1,200 cycles, which you could easily tell.
The passive was intriguing, bro.
Not to mention going,
Sounds like a very tough job. How did you get, you then transitioned into actual recording for Capitol? After QC and everything.
Well, at that time, all they had was radio recorders to do the recording, the studio recording, and no studios at all.
Of their own.
So they decided that we wanted to do, first of all, they bought a tape machine, one of the first Ampexes, and we were going to record in the Capitol offices were in the upstairs over this radio Music City. The record store I was talking about was down underneath us. And we were going to put it in a little room on the main floor right at Sunset and Vine where you walked in off the street. You could walk right into this little closet that had a Scully lathe in it, because radio recorders was giving them a bad time about something or other. They didn't like the sound too much on a lot of the work they did. And they were mainly in business to record radio shows. So they bought the Scully lathe started to think about renting a studio somewhere. in one of the old studios in Hollywood. I think it was NBC, but I'm not sure now. I always told everybody it was NBC. On Melrose Avenue, which I know had one of the radio stations in it before Capitol moved in. Anyway, they took over a building that had two nice theaters upstairs that were good space for recording studio. And a pretty good recording studio could be made out of one of the downstairs places in the building. So we helped tear out all the old radio equipment and installed still vacuum tubes, everything, and put in a couple of rooms just for cutting disc masters from the big disc masters. Everything was being cut on 16-inch lacquer discs at the time before tape. And we had to transfer that down to 78 RPM, about all we did. Capitol also had a library that they leased to radio stations, transcription library. And we spent a lot of time recording that when we got the studios going. This was long before the big round building. And along came tape. Before I left Capitol, we got one of the first Ampex tape machines through the courtesy, thank you, of Bing Crosby. And NBC was right across the street at that time at Sunset and Vine. And they had a whole bunch of Scullies. So I kind of checked out how those things, what made them run. And we had our one Scully. And then we took a second one and made a tandem lathe thing. So the second lathe would do the same as the first with some aluminum tubing in between. And then along came tape for everybody. And we got some of the first tape machines. We did a lot of recording at Capitol. Recording for the transcription library.
You told me that Capitol's when you started actually doing recording. A guy named John Palladino. You said it was the first guy that you saw use a lot of microphones. You were watching how he was doing it and setting up. And you started getting involved actually in recording and engineering yourself at Capitol. And stayed for years doing that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, he had done the mixing for Capitol at Radio Recorders.
They had their own studio.
At their studio, yeah. They did a few.
Of course, they're setting up their own studio. You're assisting with that. And this is like 47, 48, something like that?
Must have been. I didn't quite keep track of all the dates, but
I know it was 1956 when you left there. So you
yeah, it was about 47, 46 maybe.
So you did a lot of recording for Capitol, first with the lathes and then with tape.
And then with tape.
And this is still all monophonic, of course.
Yeah, we were cutting first just 16-inch disc master, the actual masters. They'd do three or four takes of the same tune on one disc and pick out the one they like and transfer that down to 78.
One of the things you'll find about Roy is he tends to be rather modest. He recorded a few people at Capitol while he was there.
Stan Freeberg.
Like Stan Freeberg.
John and Marcia.
And Nat King Cole.
Nobody
Frank left. Sinatra.
John and Marcia.
Dean Martin, including the song Bats Amore. Peggy Lee, Kay Starr, Joe Stafford, Stan Kenton. You once told me that the loudest sound you ever heard was standing in front of the Stan Kenton
Orchestra. Louder than the Navy. Louder than the Navy planes.
Yes. You know, it occurs to me it might be a good moment for another quick musical interlude. This is not one that I was aware of. Mike and Rick pointed this out. This is going to be gonna be a song you've all heard, I'm pretty sure. It was a huge hit in its era. My guess is that none of the sleeves that this record came in probably identified the engineer. Back in those days, it wasn't done very often. Probably, this hit record got played on a lot of equipment in America because they sold millions of copies. That was not hardly high fidelity. But now, with the benefit of time, I'm told that there's a format here containing this song that gives us an example of the kind of work that Roy was doing way back then, probably before the vast majority of people playing it back could even derive much of what was there. But it was this kind of quality of work, because that's the only kind of work Roy knew how to do. It was the best. And this is a song by Tennessee Ernie Ford, who was in the Capitol stable. It was really the music Roy liked best in the beginning, I'm told, is country and western, Tex Ritter and stuff, right?
Must be 16 tons.
And it's called 16 Tons.
Where'd you find it?
Some people say a man is made out of mud. A poor man's made out of muscle and blood. Muscle and blood and skin and bones. A mind that's weak and a back that's strong. You load 16 tons. What do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning when the sun didn't shine. I picked up my shovel and I walked to the mine. I loaded 16 tons, a number 9 coal, and the straw boss said, well, bless my soul, you load 16 tons. What do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning, it was drizzling rain. Fighting and trouble are my middle name. I was raised in the canebrake by an old mama lion. Can't no high-toned woman make me walk the line. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. If you see me coming, better step aside. A lot of men didn't, a lot of men died. One fist of iron, the other of steel. If the right one don't get you, then the left one will. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.
Would that have been? Anybody know?
48.
Is it that far back? That far back?
I think so.
So that was made on a Scully lathe, right?
I guess so, yeah.
So it was 48.
Master was on a 16-inch 33.
Yeah. It wasn't much else.
I don't remember how many takes they did. But we couldn't edit them. We did one trick edit job, I don't know if I ever told you, with a famous record at the time, was Pee Wee Hunt, 12th Street Rag, and it was on 16-inch disc, and it was about 7 minutes long for the radio transcription library that they had. And they had so many letters requesting it that they decided to make a record out of it. But we had to get it down to 3 minutes or under for a single. So we had to start out one disc and in the middle switch over to another disc and cut out about four choruses of the song. And each time we did it, it came out a little bit different, I think. And when they sell 1 million records in those days, they had to have a lot of masters. So they kept asking us, cut out some more masters. Our pressing plants wanted more discs. And we made a few good ones. But they're all a little bit different at that point in the record. That was one of the first editing jobs I ever did. We also had another trick that was pretty good for the time, I thought. On the transcriptions, they'd have, maybe 10 songs on one transcription. And we put an arrow on the disc, pressed it right into the disc on the inside by the label, and it pointed to the point on the disc where each song started. So they could put a needle in the spread between the disc, the little space, and cue up a disc without ever trying it. Didn't have too many good turntables in those days to back up and cue records with. So that was another good trick that we wasted a lot of masters on.
You said that when we talked before, you said that in those days the engineer did everything. You put out the chairs.
Oh, we did everything, yeah. Right. Set up the studio, cleaned up the studio, and ran the tape machine. Did everything. Almost ran the session sometimes.
And yet very rarely were ever...
Nobody ever put their name on the jacket or anything.
You must have some particular memories from those years. I mean, given the major people that you were working with at the time, I mean, Sinatra and Martin, people like this, from those years at Capitol, anything stand out in your mind? Any dirt you could share with us?
One of the funniest records was John and Marcia, I thought. That's all there was on the record was John. John? Went on for 3 minutes. Stan Freeberg and some other guy, one of his helpers. And a Hammond organ. Remember the Hammond organs with the whirling speakers? Yeah. Let's see, what else was there of interest? Oh boy, so many different people.
Well, by 1956, you leave Capitol and go to work for Contemporary Records. And when I heard about the history, it occurred to me I can certainly understand why Lester Koenig, the president of Contemporary, would want you.
I was kind of puzzled
why you, I mean, was that kind of a bold, risky move at the time to going with this little company when you were with Capitol Records? I mean, you were Hollywood, right? And can you tell us about how you met Lester Koenig and how that came to be that you made the decision to leave Capitol and go to work there?
Well, first of all, I had a little trouble with the head man in the studio who was in charge of pressing plants. He was worked at the biggest pressing plant in the country, in the world, I guess, back east. And Capitol bought them out, and he came, sat down in the studio, and made an office, and thought he was running the studio. So I had a little trouble, but... Lester seemed like a real honest, great guy.
Koenig did.
he was way too much of a perfectionist to make a lot of money. He spent a lot of money in every little detail of the records he was putting out.
So he was coming in to Capitol Studios and like renting studio time from Capitol while you were there. Koenig was.
Yeah.
For his label that was at the time Good Time Jazz, I think.
Yeah.
Right? He was doing Dixieland. Wasn't he doing
mostly,
modern jazz?
Yeah, mostly Dixieland. Yeah.
So he'd come into the studio and you'd actually mix sessions for him, huh?
Yeah, I helped him cut masters and did the whole thing. He was so interested in the whole thing. And he had recorded quite a bit in the San Francisco area. Turk Murphy and Bob Scobie, a couple other bands that were pretty well known, Dixieland type bands. And that was my kind of music. Country music and Dixieland I liked. Modern jazz I wasn't too interested in, but got to like it a lot. And what else can you think of?
So Koenig made you an offer to come to work for him.
Yeah.
And you took it.
I took it. Sounded like it would be a good deal. But he was so slow in getting the records out that he just seemed to be going nowhere.
Well, in 56, two things happened, if I recall. One is that Lester Koenig made the decision to start to record modern jazz.
Yeah.
And he made the decision to set up his own studio.
And
now, in your case, you knew very little about the former, modern jazz. You knew a lot about the latter, setting up a studio, having done it for Columbia, but you'd, or for Capitol, but you'd never done it in the absence of money and space before. Right? Could you talk about that a little bit?
Absence of what?
Of money and space.
And space, right.
Right.
Ended up in the shipping room. Well, a small building in on Melrose Place in Hollywood. And you walk in off the street, and there'd be an office on one side of the door and a couple more on the other side. You go through a door, and in the back was a shipping room. And we took over we had to leave the records that were on the shelf ready to be shipped out were still there. Well, we recorded off in one corner of this area, cleaned it off. Then he got involved with cutting his own masters because he didn't like what he was getting from whoever was doing it for him. So we bought a old Western Electric cutting lathe that supposedly, and I imagine it was the true story, was the one that they used when they did the Al Jolson original sound. Real hot dog, 33 and a third only. Direct drive motor. And we modified that, made it variable pitch and put in all the little tricks. Bought the first stereo cutting head. And we had so much trouble with that, trying to make a decent sounding disc. And then we had nothing to play it with except a Westrex playback cartridge.
So by this time, you've got two channel tape decks that you're using when you're recording.
And what?
You're using two. You're recording in stereo at this point in time, right?
Yeah.
So this machine is to make the master that you're talking about. Yeah. But we've made the transition to stereo now.
The thing you heard. Sonny Rollins was done on that lathe originally. I don't know if that came from Japan or where it came from. But.
Yeah, I'm not sure what format we were listening to there.
I think that was the contemporary record.
The LP?
Cut.
I was done on that same lathe.
But that transition to stereo came right in late 56 into 57. So you had one of the first Westrex stereo cutting heads and one of the early Ampex two-channel tape decks, am I right? Koenig bought one day?
Yeah. Yeah, one of the first, Capitol, we had number two or something. Bing Crosby had number one. That was just mono. But at Contemporary, we had Ampexes, 400, 300, I forget the number now. Anyway, just the two track to begin with.
So you set up in the shipping room?
Yeah, in a little booth off, overlooking the shipping room on one side.
You told me once you had a couple of Altec coaxial speakers in your little control room, so to speak.
That was sort of the standard at Capitol, was Altec speakers. So we continued on with that. Lester had pretty good results, no problems with Capitol. He lacked everything he did there. So we just continued on doing the same.
I know that you told me.
And then, but to get the stereo thing going, we really had a trouble because there was, cutting head was so god-awful sounding. And no way to prove, no way to play it back. So we finally found I guess it was a Shure cartridge. It was supposedly stereo, and you could play a mono record and it sounded good. It sounded the same as playing it on a mono. That's what we looked for. And we went by that. And then we matched the cutting head to make the record, to make the cartridge that we had come up with, play the record back and sound the same as the master tape at that time.
I know that when we talked before, it seemed that an important part of the story of how you did it, I mean, what this recording process was that you were using with these early generation Ampexes at the time, that a lot of the story kind of revolves around the microphones that Lester Koenig bought and what that led you to. Lester was known as a perfectionist for one, kind of a penny pincher, either by inclination or necessity, perhaps a little of both, but he was very willing to spend money where he thought it really mattered, and he purchased some very expensive microphones, and that he had those when you got there, right?
Yeah, right. He carried them around with him and at his sessions he was doing at Capitol.
So even before,
he was the only guy that would bring in his own mics.
And what were they?
Now you want me to remember. I think it was an AKG. Is that what a mic?
From Austria, I think you told me AKG.
Big long.
And then Neumann's from Germany.
U47,
before it was called the U47, I think.
Well, we had lots of Neumanns. He brought back a couple of Neumanns to begin with, too. But he was using his C12, I think. AKG, I think.
Yeah.
Or is that a dog?
I think American Kennel. Right.
AKC. American Kennel. Anyway, those mics had tubes in them, all of them. And we switched over finally to a mixing panel that had something in it. The first, I don't know how many, I don't know when we stopped using the, what did we call it, high level mixing, come right out of the microphone into the mixer, the pots that we turned. You had to turn them in those days.
No sliders yet.
No sliders yet, no. And the level was so good, so high out of those original condenser mics that they had to put attenuators in them to cut them down so it didn't overload the input of a mic preamp. So we figured, well, we'll just put a pot in there instead and mix that way. So that simplified a lot of things.
So you made that board yourself, or that little mixing board?
Probably this Sonny Rollins was done with pots like that, right in the mic circuit.
And when I talked to Bernie Grundman years ago when I was doing this article, he said, Roy was making the best sound in the business by cutting corners. It was such a clean signal path. All the gain that was needed for the mixing function came right off the microphone preamps. Roy could mix like that on the fly.
Oh yeah, dear old Bernie.
You know, maybe it's a good time for another another music interlude, and we are extremely fortunate to have the perpetrators here, not only of the engineering but of the music in this case. And maybe what we'll do is play the music first and then get some input from Bill Smith. I think that could be very interesting. This is recorded, what year? Anybody remember? Anybody know? Is it on the sleeve? 1960 maybe?
Yeah, 59 or 60.
59 or 60. And this is a song I won't identify because you're all gonna know the song, but this is Bill Smith, Through the Magic of Roy DuNann, 1960.
With Jim Hall and Shelly Mann.
I should have mentioned that. With Jim Hall on guitar, Shelly Mann on drums, and bass player?
Can't remember.
Ray Brown was the bass player on the Sonny Rollins piece that we played. Leroy Vinegar was in the mix in those days, so it could be something like that.
Thank you.
since we've now got our second person who was present at the creation there, maybe you could share a few memories with us of what it was like recording there, and anything specific about, you know, that session.
Well, in 1955, I moved to L.A. How shall I face? to take a teaching job as assistant professor at the University of Southern California. And one of my fellow students from the University of California, where I had studied with Roger Sessions, introduced me to Lester Koenig, who was a very kind gentleman. And he liked my music. We played him some tapes of my things, both jazz and classical. And he invited me to write something for one of his sessions. He said, Bill, can you, now we have long playing records. I said, what's that? Before that, I'd only recorded one album on Fantasy with Dave Rubeck, and that was around 1950, maybe a little before we had tape. So we just walked into the studio, did one take of each of the several tunes, and went home. There was no chance to edit or to do a second take. That was it. Anyway, that was my only previous recording experience, and I was amazed to hear before I got to my first contemporary date that now you could have tape and you could edit it. And I said, cut it and splice in different takes. I went, God, that's amazing. Doesn't it make a click where you edit the tape? No. So anyway, Lester said, could you write a 20-minute piece for me to take advantage of this new LP? And I said, sure. So being a new professor at USC, I thought Mozart, the Mozart divertimento, is about 20 minutes. So I'll write a divertimento. He wanted me to write for Red Norvo's group and include me performing in it. So I said, sure, I'll write a 20-minute piece. And I wrote it for Vibes, Red Norvo, clarinet, myself, guitar, Barney Kessel, who was just wonderful, Red Mitchell bass, Shelly Mann drums, Buddy Collette alto flute, and they were marvelous. And Roy was marvelous. I just took it for granted at that time, you know, but over the years, looking back, I've made many recordings and never been more satisfied with those dates at contemporary. I did 5 albums, 3 jazz, divertimento the first year, and then another 20-minute composition with Shelly Mann and his men for 9-piece group with clarinet solo. Concerto for clarinet and combo, that was called. And then the third jazz album was this one. Bill Smith Quartet with Jim Hall, Shelly Mann, and Monty Budwig was the bass player. And on all of those, I remember, you know, walking into this warehouse, much less elegant than this room. I mean, you know, it was like just records stacked around that they were getting ready to ship out. And concrete, it was just all concrete. And so I had no recording experience except for Fantasy. And Fantasy at that time hadn't recorded jazz. They had recorded Chinese language albums that they sold in Chinatown. And Brubeck was very clever, was getting a lot of airplay at that time through a San Francisco disc jockey, Jimmy Lyons, who later became important in, well, started the Monterey Jazz Festival and continued through for many years. Anyway, Dave was able to talk them into recording a jazz album, and they did one of his trio records, I think, first, and then they did the octet. So that was my only previous experience. And they did a good job, too, actually, except for the clarinet sound was terrible. I mean, you know, it sounded like I was playing a pea shooter in the next room because I was far from the mic. And with Roy, I always remember he got such a beautiful sound out of my clarinet. I thought, geez, that's great. And the microphone was right, you know, so close to the clarinet that I had this. Well, Lester complained. He said, well, Bill, we're getting your breath sounds and key clicks. You know, what can you do about that? Geez, I don't know, Lester. So I continued to breathe and click. anyway, I thought Roy was trying to get a good sound from my clarinet. I later, in this article, I noticed you were trying to get clean sound from one instrument and isolate it from the others, right?
Something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure, I know that you also was getting aware that this got a good sound from the instruments, because all the instruments at that time, we were all closely mic'd. And so there was much presence for the flute and the guitar, every instrument. And I remember coming into the record sessions, this warehouse is always, you know, we'd come in and it always was set up, which I didn't know that Roy had done it, but Roy set it up. And it seems to me there were baffles. Were there baffles or am I?
Yeah, he had a few, you know.
Yeah. And
echo chamber in the corner.
I didn't, you didn't remember know about that. I didn't remember that. No, but I know. But you did a good job with it.
Also the ladies' room.
No. So, I did those three jazz albums and then two albums of my classical compositions, the string quartet and the piece for soprano and cello. I mean, Lester always hired the musicians and got always the very best musicians. And I had heard that he had hired Roy from Capitol, and he didn't want to spend the money on a recording studio, but he wanted to get the best engineer of that day, and he hired Roy. I hope for a lot of money, I don't know. Anyway, these were also recorded in that little warehouse and with equally impressive results. So I am indebted to Roy.
Well, we are real close to wrapping here, and then we're going to throw this open for questions. Just really a couple more things. As we were talking about process earlier, recording process, I thought maybe you could just briefly speak to the reverb issue, because I know that there have been reissues of your recordings on labels. I know one is Original Jazz Classics that took the tape and simply digitized it, and they sound kind of funny because they're really bone dry. Could you talk a little bit about how you did reverb?
We did it as we mastered the lacquers to go to the pressing plants. None on the original tape to begin with. And then he was afraid we put on too much. And what'd he do? Can't take it off. Or he couldn't take it off in those days. So anyway, we never had any reverb on the original tape. But when we cut the master to go to the pressing plant, we added, we had a way of calibrating, adding the same amount every time we hoped.
With an EMT plate, right? You use an EMT plate?
Yeah, EMT, 4x8 plate. It was pretty good.
It worked pretty well?
Yeah. We had pretty good chambers at the Capitol in the old days. We had some real good chambers at A&M, but they hardly used them.
You know, one of the reasons, of course, that people are still interested in going back to these recordings that Roy made is because the music is so strong, obviously. Lester Koenig had taste. He he recorded the best players on the West Coast at the time and the best East Coast players that he could get when they came through town, like Sonny Rollins. I mean, you had experience in the studio, not only with Bill Smith, but with a whole host of interesting people, like Art Pepper, who even by jazz standards was not a clean liver, we're told. But you've recorded Art a couple times and made some classics with him. One thing I thought was interesting was one example of Koenig's boldness at the time was that he made the first two recordings of Ornette Coleman. At a time when Ornette Coleman couldn't get a gig in Los Angeles, he made two records with Ornette. I was at the IAJE convention in New York last January, the International Association for Jazz Education, which is the big world gathering of jazz annually. And Ornette Coleman was there and was interviewed, kind of like this, except about 4,000 more people there, in a live interview at IAJE. Of course, Coleman is treated like one of the great living masters, of course. You knew him when? In 1958.
Yeah.
What was it like recording Ornette for the first time when nobody had ever heard that stuff before, right? That he was playing then.
I was thinking, how am I going to edit this?
Any other?
Who's the other weirdo that?
Art Pepper, maybe? No. Not Hampton Hawes.
No. Well, he was a pretty good pianist.
Pretty good pianist. People think so.
Very good. No, another one that I couldn't figure the music out at all. Like Ornette Coleman.
Is that right? So you're having a little trouble with Ornette. It was 1958, after all. He was a little ahead of his time in 1958.
Yeah.
You know, it's probably not necessary to tell this group, I suppose, but engineers really don't get enough credit, by and large, for their contribution to, you know, the history that we share. I was reading an interview with Keith Jarrett not long ago. And Jarrett is somewhat unique among jazz musicians in that he's an audiophile. At least at one point it was pretty hardcore, into cable and tube equipment and stuff. But he also has been very frustrated throughout his career by his unhappiness with his own recordings. And he's been very critical of the recording process generally. I interviewed him once for an article and he told me that most recordings are like a fax of the event. But this was a recent interview. It was not intended as a compliment to say it was like a fax of the event. In this recent interview, he was going on that theme, which is a theme that he often revisits. And he was saying, you know, one example of something that was really good were those old contemporaries. You know, if we could just do it that way. But even then, even Jarrett, and even recently, you know, didn't know the engineer's name. Didn't name the person, but he, you know, his association is, you know, he remembers those old contemporaries. So maybe just to wrap here before we turn it over, if I might be permitted the somewhat vain prospect of quoting myself, only because I think that it really does speak to what we've been visiting here tonight with Roy. This is very close to the end of the piece that I wrote in 2002. When he left Contemporary, he took none of the LPs with him. Mm-hmm. He was unaware that there had been audiophile reissues of his albums, such as the Analog Productions LP of Way Out West. He had never heard of the JVC XR CD series. Roy is embarrassed when extravagant praise of his work is read to him. When I point out that over and over, authorities no less than Jim Anderson mention how Roy's recordings, quote, put you in the room, unquote, with the musicians, Roy just smiles. It doesn't compute, he says. We never tried for anything like that. We just tried to balance the instruments to keep separation so people would think it was stereo. But Roy's modesty cannot obscure his achievement. Eric Dolphy once said, when you hear music after it's over, it's gone in the air. You can never capture it again. Until the mid-50s, it was pretty much true. Music, especially improvised music, is a very different art form from painting or literature. Its preservation beyond the moment is dependent upon its delivery system. the recording. Charlie Parker died in 1955, and those of us who never heard him live will never know much about what he sounded like. But thanks to Roy DuNann, thanks to his genius for mixing on the fly at 3 a.m., thanks to his intuitive respect for a clean signal path, thanks to his willingness to set up the studio fresh for each session, thanks to his constant fussing over his equipment, checking, tweaking, rebiasing, we possess vivid knowledge of what Sonny Rollins sounded like when he was 27, and Art Pepper in his prime, and Ornette Coleman as he sounded before he came east and turned New York on its ear. Before I put away my Sony portable recorder and gather up the CDs spread over the dining room table, I read Roy and Dorothy, I was in their home, a quote from Bernie Grundman. Roy did a lot for this industry. He showed us all how good it could be. His best recordings are not just good for their era. They are some of the best sounding recordings of all time. So I think this is an opportunity for all of us tonight to thank somebody that doesn't get thanked enough and say, thank you, Roy, for what you've given us. As promised, we're going to have some opportunity for questions from the floor for all the stuff we missed.
Roy? On a lot of that earlier stuff, it's very definitely that early stereo, hard pan, hard assigned, left, right sort of stuff. Am I correct in that first? That, like...
Left the, and right.
What?
First of all, we only had one switch, left and right.
Right, yeah.
For a microphone.
When did
one channel or the other.
When did you start getting into the band?
Then we faded one in between, you know, we could take some of the, each channel and put it in the middle and all that stuff.
When did you start getting into that, and what was your idea about that at that point in time?
I have no idea.
You know, it wasn't... So it wasn't
We were listening to... some of the other albums, and they weren't all like ours, so we thought we better try something else, maybe.
I sort of have a two-part question. When you were balancing the instruments, how did you do that? Did you just like move the instruments around the room and say, you guys need to move a couple inches or whatever? And when you were doing this, especially for jazz, there's always there's sometimes a solo. So the second part is, did you always know who was going to solo, and how did you make sure that they were heard in the recording as opposed to getting, you know, covered over by all the other instruments?
Can you break that down, Tom? So my ears are so bad now.
The first question is, how did you balance the instruments? Did you acoustically mix them in the room, moving people closer and further away?
Sometimes, yeah. Sometimes placement in the studio.
But you were not into minimalist miking like Matesky is, for example, a label that's out there now where they hang one stereo microphone down in the room. You were multiple miking, close miking, but still...
Yeah, Capitol started that multiple miking business, I think. Lots of microphones.
And the question about the
solos.
Yeah, and a good question about, you know, jazz. He was saying jazz, of course, is usually just like we heard the first track. It was only a trio. It was Sonny Rollins, Ray Brown, and Shelly Mann. But they all solo. They may, and, you know. But in larger ensembles, how did you deal with the solo in jazz? Did you have the solo plan in advance? Did you know what was coming?
Yeah, sort of. We usually did everything in more than one take. Did the same song over and over a few times, even in the jazz. They always thought they could do better. Lots of times they didn't. use take one after all.
We were going to have as a fourth example a larger ensemble that Roy recorded, which would be, I suppose, from a balancing act standpoint, and who's playing the solo and all that sort of stuff. It'd be a little more of a challenge because of time, we're not playing that right now. But I don't know, maybe when we're totally done here, if someone wants to stick around and listen to that, it's interesting stuff. By the way, just from my own standpoint, I'm an LA guy. I remember my dad was in the studios, and I kind of hung around some of those guys when I was a kid. Just as a side man, you know, one of the lesser important guys on this particular cut that we had picked out was a guy named Vince DeRosa. I don't know if any of you have heard of Vince DeRosa or not, but Vince DeRosa is the most recorded French horn player in the history of the instrument. He's the guy you hear when you hear that great French horn sound in the movies more than anyone else. It'd be Vince DeRosa, if not Vince, maybe Decker, maybe a few of the Brits, and a couple of guys in New York, and you know, but I mean, there were a handful of guys, but DeRosa more than anybody else defined that sound. And what's interesting is, he's a side man somewhere in the back. In fact, there's the picture of Vince in the contemporary record story. You see, barely, there's DeRosa down here in the back or something. It's interesting how these guys went in there. It wasn't really, they liked what they were doing. They liked what they were doing, and so they would do whatever it was. So
they were always put in the back because they're horns.
Yeah, right. they're a nightmare to control.
it's a great sound.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many channels did you have on the mixing boards in those days?
How many channels?
Yeah. How many microphones could you work with?
Well, it varied all over the place.
Sure.
I don't know. I sure wouldn't remix everything from 32 tracks again.
It's never the same.
The old days we had to cover records. Somebody get a hit record on some little label, we had to cover it. We had to have a session the next day or that night and get them out fast. Not come back 3 days later and do the whole session over again on a 16 track or something.
That's for Capitol, probably.
Yeah, back in the old Capitol days. No, they were doing it when I left, going to a whole bunch of tracks, wasting time.
Is your hand over there somewhere? Yes.
Wondering what do you see that contributed to your hearing loss? Was it working with the music, or were there other things that you did in your life that impacted your hearing?
I couldn't get anything.
He wonders if some of the work that you did in the field contributed to your hearing loss, or do you have other vices you'd like to share with us that may have
Well. I think it started at Capitol. First time I had to go see a hearing doctor. I was pretty young then. Probably started before that around the Navy days.
Sure.
All the aircraft. I used to have to do a lot of flying. I wasn't a pilot, but flew a lot on radar training ships and whatnot.
So you're saying that even when you were mixing on the fly those contemporary recordings, your hearing was not 100%.
I guess I knew about it, but I don't think I was wearing a hearing aid. They all sound so bad. They're horrible. I can't listen to music.
Who was building your equipment? Were you building it?
Was that what?
Who was building your equipment?
The equipment itself in the in the contemporary days?
Yeah.
Me. And Howard Holzer. Anybody ever hear of Howard? He got his name on quite a few albums.
Yeah, if you look back at some of the early contemporaries, you'll see Howard Holzer's name as well as Roy DuNann. Died in a plane crash.
He was in the maintenance department at Capitol, and the only one that really knew what he was doing, and it was a radio ham too. So I dragged him over to Contemporary, and we the two of us really built the place.
He died early in a private plane crash, am I right?
Hmm?
Howard Holzer, did he die in a plane crash?
Yeah, Mexico City.
When he was still quite young.
Yeah, very young.
There was another question over there somewhere.
I had one.
Yeah.
I was just curious, we didn't have any piano in the musical examples that we heard, but did you have any
particular approach to miking a piano?
Good question.
Tried everything. One thing, he would always rent the best piano he could get. He usually got it from Felix Slatkin, I think his name. Orchestra leader had a real big grand piano. They call them studio pianos, I think. He was the only one that the guy would allow to go out on a rental, would be to our place.
Mm-hmm.
So we always had a good piano there. And tune it up every day, too.
Yeah.
Capital, we used to tune the pianos.
For those who don't know, Felix Slatkin was a conductor of the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra. He had an excellent string quartet. Probably the one rap on that string quartet was that the name of it was the Hollywood String Quartet. But if you just listen to the musicians, the playing, it's an excellent group. In fact, Felix Slatkin's wife, Eleanor Aller, a cellist, is a great cellist.
Yeah.
And the one bad rap on Eleanor was that she was a woman in those days. But if you just go by the playing, excellent, wonderful cellist. So anyway, that's a good guy to rent a piano from. His son now conducts the National Symphony, by the way, Lenny.
What about miking it, Roy? He was asking about how you said you tried everything. You were frustrated?
I don't remember. We probably used AKGs. I don't remember. Whatever was available. We didn't
more,
have
more
too many.
Than one.
We didn't have too many. We got more microphones here than we ever had, I think.
Not looks
I don't know if
do you remember if you would you just use one on the piano, or would you try to use more than one, or would it depend?
Do you remember? I didn't get
that. How many microphones did you use on the piano?
Sometimes two. Yeah, that was about the most.
Sure.
And where would they place them?
Well, we covered
sometimes
that
inside, sometimes
inside.
Above. Joe Finger's car. Anybody ever hear of him?
Oh yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay.
He was a producer at Capitol. Real name was Lou Bush. Recorded him a lot.
Yep. Goodness sakes.
He was one of the original honky tonk.
Yeah.
Two of the best selling albums at the time, I think, the Canon Cat were Andre Previn albums, one West Side Story, one My Fair Lady.
Was the best selling one he ever had.
My Fair Lady.
Yeah.
A jazz
at
hit.
That time when I left.
Yeah. And that was recorded in your shipping room, huh?
Right.
With a rented piano from that?
Probably, yeah. I think we had a pretty good piano. No, I don't remember. We had a little piano there, I think. Didn't use it much.
Yes.
I wanted to ask Roy what he did after Contemporary. You mentioned A&M. Could you talk a minute maybe about what you did after the Contemporary period?
Really?
Summarize 35 years for us quickly. 40. I know that you moved to Phoenix after you left Contemporary.
Right. About 10 years in Phoenix at a new studio that we built and recorded a lot of radio commercials. That was about it.
And then went to L.A., right?
And then I went to Herb Alpert. He was just bought the Charlie Chaplin motion picture lot on Sunset and Vine. No, Sunset and La Brea.
Sunset and La Brea. For A&M Records.
A&M, yeah. Do you want a price?
Now, at this point, you're
By the time I went to A&M, he decided to spend all the money on the studio. He'd made all his money from recording at Gold Star, of all places.
And you were a maintenance engineer there, sort of...
Yeah.
Administering all the equipment, huh?
Yeah.
I know Roy told me once
we had four studios. We had the biggest studio in Hollywood, actually. Well, in Charlie Chaplin, so Lott converted a couple of the big motion picture barns into studios.
Which, of course, was Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass, and A&M became a huge label, not just for Herb Alpert, but for many others. I remember when we talked earlier, Roy told me that he would go to work and the smell of marijuana would be almost overpowering. Yes.
What about drum kits? Any microphone techniques or like number of microphones, placement of microphones?
Drum kits. Any techniques there as far as number of microphones, placement of microphones? I know you used to have some kind of stuff draped over the drums.
Kind
of. Right?
Yeah.
I saw a picture. Well, not exactly a baffle, but you got good results. How'd you do it on the drums?
Usually with two microphones.
Where?
And the drummer knew what he was doing, you know. He could hear the first take and correct himself. And kind of baffles on the side, if I remember right. Otherwise, it's just a cement wall. No soundproofing at all, just cement.
There's a white van outside and the dome light's on.
That's probably mine.
Any other questions? Yes.
What do you listen to now?
Like what?
What do you listen to now?
What do you listen to now?
Oh, very little. My wife leaves the room, leaves the building if I turn the speakers up so I can hear it. So I gotta wear, I wear cordless big Sony headphones and listen that way, and she can listen to anything then, but that's not the greatest either. Best I could do and be married. She's got the greatest ears. Oh, golly, she hears things. And she hears a siren going down through the main street of Bothell, and she's afraid it's coming to her building.
She hears too well. Any other questions?
Well, listen, you did enjoy your career. You were happy with what you did.
Yeah.
Went to work every day, smiling.
Yeah. Horrible hours, though. Oh. Didn't you have terrible hours?
Oh, you're right.
Yeah, and you start at 4 in the morning to record.
And get up again and start at 8.
Yeah. So that used to bother my wife a lot, terrible hours.
Normal. My wife, too. I think she's still upset about it. But I enjoyed it. It was the best thing in the world for me. I was so happy.
I don't think we ever really mentioned that, but you know, that was that reference in what I read to 3 a.m., mixing on the fly at 3 a.m., is that so many of these sessions were after the gig. You know, Rollins was playing somewhere in town. He wasn't really in town except to play. The only chance you had to record him was after the gig, so Roy's in there. At 3 o'clock in the morning,
sure.
You know, so not great hours. But.
Well, there was a comment in the Contemporary Record Story notes saying that they might start around 10 o'clock and that they felt maybe the musicians were at their best. Interesting comment.
Yeah. Night people
could very well be.
Did somebody say they tore the building down? Did you tell me that?
I didn't. No.
I think somebody said that. Too long ago.
Do you think that the recording sessions of today or the engineers of today are better or worse than the engineers of yesteryear?
No,
Loaded that. Question, huh?
Well,
I don't know. Too many knobs on the consoles. Everybody asks me, what do they do with all those knobs? I don't know.
Any other questions? You know, we had talked earlier about, Mike had mentioned this track that we were going to play. Maybe it's a good way to actually, it's only 3 minutes long, so maybe it's a good way to end things. This was a session's famous, legendary, classic session called Art Pepper Plus 11. How did you get 12 people in there? That must have been a challenge in itself. 12,
you
set
know.
Up a big band in that place, right?
Yeah, that was a big band. Sure, there was 12. Maybe they came in twice. Only six. Overdone.
Well, this is an example of Roy's work with a larger ensemble. That's a famous album, as I say. It's a track called Erigen, which is Nigeria spelled backwards. I think Sonny Rollins wrote Erigen, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. This Art Pepper, Pete Candoli, Jack Sheldon, Art Pepper alto sax, Pete Candoli and Jack Sheldon were trumpets, Dick Nash trombone, Bob, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Enev Oldson.
Oh, yeah.
Valve trumpet, interesting. Tenor sax. Vince DeRosa, French horn. Herb Geller, alto sax. Med Florey, baritone sax. Russ Freeman, piano. Joe Mondragon, bass. Mel Lewis, drums.
Mel Lewis.
And it was arranged and conducted by Marty, is it Page?
Page.
Marty Page.
Yeah, he was a neighbor of mine.
Here.
This is it?
Yeah.
Thank you.
You sure my name's on that?
Positive. Okay, thank you very much for having me. It was a lot of fun.
What year was that one?
59,
was
it?
So. Wow.
Thank you, Tom.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah.
Great.
Thank you.